I'm thrilled to introduce our keynote speaker for this evening, or this afternoon, I should say, Steve Olson. Steve is a senior research fellow at Heinrich. He also is a special advisor at the Hong Kong University of Science and Technology. His career started, though, in Washington, D.C. as a trade negotiator. He was involved in NAFTA. In the past 30 years, he has worked in senior positions in the Middle East and across Asia, which makes him perfect for this next address, getting at a lot of issues about how the global trade situation has emerged to the point that it has, and what we can expect in the next 5 years and beyond. So without further ado, thank you, Steve.
Thank you. Well, look, thank you very much. Warm welcome again. I'm thrilled to see all of you here. Thank you very much for coming. We're delighted to have this opportunity to host you here at the Heinrich Foundation headquarters. I have to confess, I always look forward to sessions like this with journalists for a variety of reasons, not the least of which is, and I'm being completely sincere, I hold your profession in very, very high regard. I think that the founding fathers of the United States back in the 1700s demonstrated tremendous wisdom in recognizing and protecting the role of a free press, recognizing it as being central to democracies, and I would argue just healthy societies anyplace. So you guys have an incredibly important job. I'm pleased that you're doing it. Thank you very much. The other thing is I grew up in a family of newspaper readers, so my earliest memories are sitting at the breakfast table with a bowl of cereal, reading the New York Daily News to see how the New York Yankees did. Now it's 50 years later, the only thing that's changed is now I read it from an iPad, but still checking on the Yankees. All right, so let's turn our attention to our topic for this afternoon, global trade at an inflection point. And I want to start my comments by making a remark that will be blindingly obvious to every single person in this room, and that is there is a ton of stuff going on right now in international trade. We just emerged from the first ministerial conference in the WTO in more than 4 or 5 years. The United States is launching a new economic framework agreement for the Indo-Pacific. We're still assessing the trade fallout from both the pandemic and the Ukraine war. U.S.-China trade tensions certainly have not subsided, and we still continue to face a populist backlash against international trade. So a ton of stuff going on. All of those specific issues are very important, and we can and we should discuss those specific points to whatever extent you're interested in. But I want to start our conversation from a very different perspective. I want to start our conversation by taking a step back and trying to view this very, very, very busy global trade horizon through a much broader lens. I think what frequently happens when there's so much stuff going on all at once is that we can lose our ability to see the forest because we have to focus. This issue just broke on US-China. This issue just broke on WTO. And we have to focus immediately on the trees immediately in front of our face. And we lose that ability to see the bigger picture and the broader tapestry. So what I want to do is sketch out for you a little bit of that broader tapestry so that as you're focused on the individual threads, you're also mindful of bigger picture and that broader tapestry. So from my point of view, here's what that bigger picture looks like. Our existing rules-based global trade system, which was established in the immediate aftermath of the Second World War and has been a primary driver of economic development and rising standards of living for more than 70 years is in the process of unraveling in front of our eyes. Okay? And in order to understand how we got here, where we are, and where we might be headed, I think it'll be useful to take a couple minutes and remind ourselves how and why was our existing rules-based global trade system established in the first place in the aftermath of the Second World War, and what has brought us to this critical inflection point that we're at now. Now look, in a very real and a very literal sense, the system we're operating under today and the trade system that all of you are covering today rose out of the ashes of the Second World War and the Great Depression. Now, I want you to go through a little bit of a thought experiment. I want you to imagine that you are one of the architects of this new post-World War II system that we're trying to set up in the aftermath of the Depression and World War II. So if you're one of these architects, you're a global leader. So by definition, what do we know about you? We know that you are a white man, probably in your 50s, okay? So you're a white man in his 50s in 1948. Reflect on your life. Your adult life has been an uninterrupted string of catastrophes, okay? When you were a young man, what did you do? You fought in World War I. The war to end all wars, the first modern war, the war that expanded our conception of how much suffering a war could create. But somehow you managed to come through that. You got through the chemical warfare. You got through the poison gas attacks of World War I. You came through that. You said, now my life's going to be easy. Great Depression. Not that many years later. Now, everybody here lived through the global financial crisis. That was a walk in the park, okay? That was a day at the beach compared to the Great Depression. Not that many years after you began to suffer through the Great Depression, the Second World War, which was worse than the first, and of course culminated in, for the first time and hopefully the last time, human beings dropping a nuclear bomb on other human beings and incinerating two cities off of the face of the map, off the face of the earth. So drink all that in. It's 1948, you're assessing, how are we going to create this new world order? You recognize we've really screwed up. Whatever we've been doing, whatever approach we've been taking to running this world, we screwed it up. Look at the last 30 years. World War, Depression, another World War. You're thinking to yourself, if we keep doing the same thing, we're going to send our kids to fight World War III in what, 1965, 1966? That's what your expectation would be. So there is a strong recognition that we've really got to create a new system, a new global system. We've got to do things differently. And so the pillars of this new system would be global cooperation, try to get global rules in place, and establish multilateral organizations that were going to help people keep everything, help keep us in line, and help facilitate the ability of countries to work out their problems without dropping nuclear bombs on each other's heads. Okay? So these were the Bretton Woods. These were the Bretton Woods institutions that you know well, the United Nations, World Bank, IMF, as Alex mentioned. And free trade was an absolute centerpiece of this new world order that you were trying to construct in the aftermath of the Second World War. Now, free trade was important both for economic and geopolitical reasons. Free trade was important for economic reasons because it was understood that protectionism in the form of the Smoot-Hawley tariffs and the resulting global trade war that it launched was a primary driver of the Great Depression. It didn't cause the Depression, it made it worse, and it made it last longer. The picture now we see is probably a little bit more nuanced, but set that aside. In 1948, protectionism was a big part of what got you into all of these problems. So it was recognized that our new world order had to be based on free trade and working against protectionism. But it wasn't just about economics, because these global architects, these founders of the post-World War II system, explicitly recognized and believed in the role of trade in helping to maintain peace. There was a strong, strong feeling that we want to knit countries together. We want to develop economic interdependence among countries, because the belief was, well, look, if we've all got to depend on each other for international trade, we're probably a lot less likely to go to war. And it was also recognized that all of us have a joint stake in the prosperity of other countries. Because when you eliminate when you make countries prosperous and eliminate situations of economic distress, you're also limiting reasons for countries to go to war. I mean, Germany was economically punished after the First World War. It gave rise to a crazy person by the name of Hitler who brought us down to World War II. So the idea was, we've all got a vested interest in making all countries economically prosperous, and that will undercut the rationale for war. Now, as we were going about the work of setting up this new rules-based global trade system, there was a real cooperative spirit, a sense that we're all in this together, that we're working on a joint endeavor that's going to benefit all of us, and there is a very, very high level of trust. Okay? Now, and so in 1948, we established the predecessor organization to the WTO that was called the GATT, General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade. Now, in the early decades of this new post-World War II order, I can tell you very succinctly what the trade agenda was all about. Primarily three things. Number one, tariffs. Number two, tariffs. And number three, tariffs. Because keep in mind, as a result of Smoot-Hawley, which raised US tariffs to record levels and then encouraged all the major trading countries in the world to do the same thing, we had incredibly high tariff walls. And these were the primary impediment to trade. They were the primary form of protectionism. And once you've had a 45% tariff in place for 12 years, you don't go to zero immediately. It's too disruptive. And so over a series of multilateral rounds that were negotiated in those subsequent decades, the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, our primary job, let's start bringing those tariff walls down. Let's start bringing those tariff walls down. So I would characterize this as it was very methodical, it was very workmanlike, and we knew what the job was. Now gradually over time, as we took care of tariffs and got tariff levels to a more manageable level, then we could turn our attention to some other issues, non-tariff barriers, et cetera. But clearly for the first three, four decades of this system, it was all about tariffs. Now, so 50s, 60s, 70s, into the 80s. But when we got into the 1980s, when Alex and I were starting our careers in Washington, D.C. as trade guys, by the time we got into the 1980s, this idea about free trade and globalization really started to take off. And I think, and Alex used the term, and I think it's absolutely 100% right, this wasn't globalization. We started going into an era of hyper-globalization. So, for example, think of, take international trade as a percentage, global international trade as a percentage of global GDP, okay? Use that as an approximate barometer for globalization and economic interdependence. Global trade as a percentage of global GDP. Now, if you look at 150 years worth of economic data, you'll see that it was gradually increasing, a few historical blips, but basically increasing over 150 years. Then you come to the 1980s. 1980s, that line starts going straight up. starts going through the roof. We hit a real period of hyper-globalization. So what was behind this? What was driving it? What was taking place? Well, a few different things. One is we'd had a few decades of experience, you know, pursuing this goal of globalization and free trade, and we were starting to see some very impressive results. We were starting to see some very remarkable economic development stories as a result of globalization and free trade. The country we happen to be gathered in today being a perfect example of one of those success stories. And globalization, we started to see globalization not only just as a policy choice and a policy option, but we started to regard it almost as a scientific fact. It was just a given. Globalization was here. Globalization was going to continue, period. These were the times, and it's amusing and sometimes a little bit cringeworthy to go back and read these things today. But you know, this was an era in which U.S. President Bill Clinton compared globalization to an unstoppable force of nature. Clinton said, globalization is like the wind. And of course, nobody's going to stop the wind. And Tony Blair, British Prime Minister, said that it was ridiculous to even question if globalization was going to intensify, and that even questioning the intensification of globalization was like questioning, will winter come after autumn? Okay, so this was the mindset. Another interesting thing was taking place during these years. We see literally all around the world, from India to Mexico and every place in between, we see a wave of Western-educated technocratic economists, typically coming out of big-time jobs in the IMF and the World Bank, moving into leadership positions in various governments. And I mean, trade ministers, finance ministers, foreign ministers, this was the resume du jour. You know, you got your PhD from Stanford University, you did your stint at IMF, now you're a trade minister, now you're a finance minister, economics minister, whatever the case might be. But even beyond that, we're talking about presidents and prime ministers coming out of this, you know, coming out of this school of thought, holding this very, very strong pro-free trade, pro-globalization ethos, and bringing those policies with them. Now, during these years, and again, I lived through this, Alex lived through this. When we were starting our career, a common set of assumptions hardened like concrete and became just chiseled in granite and taken as I said, scientific facts. And one was that, you know, these trade and investment barriers and restrictions, they were anachronisms. They were stupid mistakes we made in the past when we didn't know any better. And now we're modern, now we're sophisticated, now it's 1986. We recognize how stupid all of those trade barriers were, and we're just going to move methodically to reduce all of them as quickly as possible. Another assumption that hardened was it was inevitable. The global economy is going to get more integrated. We're just going to move greater integration, greater integration, greater integration, and globalization was thought to be a one-way street. It only moved in one direction. We were just moving to more intense globalization, period, like Clinton and Blair would suggested to us. Now, of course, the government policy choices reflected this mindset, this zeitgeist, this ethos, whatever you want to call it. So this was a period, of course, with FTAs. I had a very unusual career in the United States government as a trade guy. I participated in two free trade negotiations, two major agreements in less than 10 years, US, Canada, and then NAFTA. So this was the explosion of free trade agreements, right? But even beyond that, it's noteworthy, guys, this ethos was so strong, this belief in free trade and globalization was so strong, this was an era in which governments were just unilaterally taking down barriers. It wasn't part of a negotiation, it wasn't part of the GATT or the WTO, it wasn't part of a free trade agreement. Countries were just saying, these trade barriers are no good. They're holding us back. We're just going to unilaterally drop them. I would say, poster child for this, I would say, would be Chile, and many other Latin American countries did the same. And then, of course, we launched the Uruguay round, the most comprehensive multilateral round ever successfully concluded that set up the WTO, the World Trade Organization. Something else very important was cooking. Something else very important was taking place at this time that you've got to understand, and that was a highly symbiotic relationship formed between government and business. And they cheered each other on. The government cheered on multinational corporations. Get into foreign markets, foreign direct investments, exports, source products abroad, really encouraged and pushed private business to participate in global markets to the extent possible. And the business community returned the favor. And they cheered on the government and say, hey, we'll do it, man, but get out there. More free trade agreements. Keep that guy Steve Olson busy at USTR. We need more free trade agreements. Let's do more on a multilateral basis, bilateral, anything. So it's a highly symbiotic relationship. I recall to this day, because it was so striking, when we negotiated the US-Canada Free Trade Agreement, it was not terribly controversial, and we weren't terribly worried about congressional approval. You would not have believed the corporate support we got. The absolute who's who, up to the chairman and CEO level of all of the leading companies. This company's fallen quite a way since then, but American Express in 1988 was a much bigger deal than American Express is today. It was headed by the chairman of American Express, and they just jammed this thing through. They went out there, they sold the agreement, they put pressure on Congress, and you know, it was an incredible amount of business community support that we had for this agenda. So starting in the 1980s, we start moving towards that period of hyper-globalization. That continues 80s, 90s, early 2000s, okay? But then some things start to change. And some cracks start to appear in this very, 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 very strong, in this concrete consensus in favor of free trade and globalization. Now, I couldn't give you an exact date. I would say probably we started seeing these things reaching a critical mass. I would say probably second term of Barack Obama is when they really started becoming a significant force. But there were rising questions being raised about globalization, about particularly the social and the economic trade-offs of globalization. And a lot of average people were saying, you know, I might not be one of these really smart guys with a PhD from Stanford, and I might not have a PhD in economics from Yale University, but you know what? I've got two eyes in my head and I can see. And when I look around, it seems to me like this globalization that you guys are trying to sell me on so much seems like it's really beneficial for multinational corporations. Seems like it's worked out really well for Wall Street. Seems like it worked out well for large financial institutions. But for average workers like me, I'm not so sure we're seeing the benefits. And so these questions started reaching a critical mass. Although the phrase wasn't coined until many years later, this was when the China shock first started becoming apparent. Bill Clinton told Americans that let China into the WTO, it's going to be nothing but benefits for the United States, right? This is your dreams come true. And now it's starting to become evident, well, all we're really seeing is where's the manufacturing base in the United States, and where are the other jobs for those people to move into? Then as these questions were rising and continue to be raised, more recently, just within our immediate, I was gonna say in our immediate memory, it's not even in our memory because we're continuing to live through both of these things, but we then suffered through a couple of important systemic shocks which further cracked the started to crack this um, this consensus. Now, the first one was the pandemic. Now, the pandemic was very important because we had gotten complacent and we had forgotten some things that we shouldn't have forgotten about, but the pandemic reminded us. And that is, global trade not only can potentially bring incredible benefits, but global trade, let's face the fact, also brings a certain amount of risk and a certain amount of vulnerability, especially if your trading relationships are stretched out over these extended and tenuous global supply chains. We never should have lost sight of it, but we did. We got a little bit complacent, and the pandemic reminded us, hey guys, maybe it's time to recalibrate, because trade can bring benefit, but it also brings risk and vulnerability. And then, of course, concurrent with the pandemic, we have the war in Ukraine. And the war in Ukraine, from my point of view and from a trade perspective, brings home one really, really, really critical issue and crystallized it. And that is this economic interdependence, which we were so thrilled about. The architects after the Second World War were so thrilled about economic interdependence. We realized, you know what? That economic interdependence can be weaponized against us. Trade relationships, economic relationships, they can be weaponized against us. Okay? Now, as all of this is going on, there's another sort of macro trend taking place, and that is we're starting to realize that our trade governance is just not up to it. Okay? We were so optimistic. We came out of that 1980s period of belief in globalization. We set up the WTO and we thought, well, trade problems are done. You know, the WTO is a more muscular version, supposed to be a more muscular version of the GATT. And we thought, well, kiss trade problems behind, right? Trade disputes, trade wars, we got the WTO. The WTO is going to straighten everything out. But now, by the time we get into this period, again, I think starting roughly around the second term of Obama, we started to realize, you know, our trade governance isn't working. It's not coming to the rescue. It's not helping us. And people are looking around and saying, look, a number of countries, in particular non-market economies, in particular China, are pursuing a number of predatory trade practices that are really hurting our interests. Where's the WTO? Why can't the WTO fix it? So there's an increased recognition that, you know, the WTO isn't going to ride in on a white horse here and save the day, right? We've got real problems with our governance. And then, of course, at the same time, all of this is taking place against the backdrop of rising geopolitical tensions, again, that we're living through, you know, down to this day. This whole idea of this democracy versus autocracy mindset, furthering these divisions. Now, take half a second, take a deep breath, and, you know, compare where we are today, compare the mindset, compare the assumptions, compare our approach, our view of the world today to where we were in the immediate aftermath of the Second World War when we were setting up this system. We had a collaborative spirit. We're all in this together. Interdependence is really going to bind us together in the most positive way. And you compare that to where we are today, everything's practically been stood on its head. And so, you know, one thing to reflect on is not only it shouldn't be surprising that we're seeing this post-World War II system start to unravel, it's almost by definition inevitable. If all of the foundational principles and all of the foundational mindsets that caused you to establish that system, if they start to decay and they start to fall away, how can that system remain intact? It's very, very difficult. And so this is what we're living through. This is what you guys are covering, this breakup of this rules-based global trading system. And it's starting to accelerate. you know, I'm reminded there is that very often quoted line from Ernest Hemingway's "The Sun Also Rises," that I think applies to what we're living through today. An American expat in Paris is questioned by one of his friends in a bar. "Hey, I heard you went bankrupt. How did it happen?" To which the gentleman replies, "Gradually, then all at once." And so I think that this is now, I don't think the global trade system is falling apart all at once, but we are hitting a period of acceleration, right? These things were underway. It was gradually starting to unravel, gradually starting to unravel. Pandemic, war in Ukraine, democracy versus authoritarianism mindset. It's really starting to accelerate. So as you are writing your stories and doing your research on the big issues that you have to be focused on, those individual threads in the tapestry, WTO, US, China, impact of pandemic on trade patterns, whatever the case might be, cover those threads, but I also want you to have that ability to stand back and see how those threads weave in to this much broader tapestry. So let's then turn our attention to what this might suggest in terms of where things are headed. Well, I think a couple of things are already becoming quite clear. The first thing, and this again would be to state what is should be completely obvious to us, that post-World War II vision, that post-World War II aspiration that we had for a single, stable, deeply integrated global trade system, that's just slipping through our fingers day by day. Okay, that's just getting further and further away from us. We are inevitably heading towards a more fragmented system. And a real important point here, this more fragmented system consisting of self-selected trade blocks, it's not built on the principles that these blocks were built on in the past. It's not about economic efficiencies. Now it's much more about building your trade relationships with countries that share a common set of values, a common set of philosophies, a common geopolitical outlook. In short, friendshoring. You want to build your trading relationships with friends because you've got a heightened understanding that your trade relationships can be weaponized against you, okay? Another interesting thing, and this is something that I think it's still a little bit ambiguous as to how it's gonna play out, but I would strongly encourage you to keep your eye on this because it's gonna tell us some interesting things. So as we move towards this more fragmented world, this world of self-selected trade blocks, in the past, they would have been woven together by free trade agreements, right? By FTAs, NAFTA agreement, US-Canada free trade agreement, RCEP, CPTPP. Free trade agreements now are becoming increasingly difficult to negotiate, to conclude, to get public support for, and to get legislative support for, certainly in the US. The US is out of the business of free trade agreements for the foreseeable future, period, full stop. So in lieu of these free trade agreements, how do you build these blocks? Well, we're moving now towards these economic framework agreements, like the US Indo-Pacific Economic Framework Agreement. Very, very interesting. The Americans have been explicit. There's no market access provisions. We're not lowering trade barriers for you guys. This isn't a free trade agreement. You're not gonna enter this and get a break on tariffs or whatever the case might be. We're not going there. And in essence, what this kind of new approach to trade agreements about, I would suggest, is about constructing ecosystems. So how do you do this? You say, well, let's get together with our friends and let's work out common technical standards. Let's get together with our friends and make a bunch of joint investments in different cutting edge areas. Let's work on supply chain resiliency. Supply chain resiliency, oftentimes, of course, becoming code for let's get the heck out of China, right? Let's get this stuff out of China, okay? So it's not about a traditional free trade agreement. It's not about reducing trade barriers. It's let's make an ecosystem where we're all much more likely, it's much more conducive for all of us to do business together. Okay? Now, the other thing I would say about where this new world that we're probably headed for, whew, it is a new world for business. It is a new world for business. You know, businesses have had for decades now the luxury of being able to plan their global strategies based on economic efficiencies, based on commercial imperatives, based on profitability. You know, where do we source, where do we trade, where do we put production facilities? Those questions were just based on dollars and cents. Well, we're now moving into an era where multinational corporations no longer can make a decision about where to base a production facility based on an Excel spreadsheet. It used to be just a simple Excel spreadsheet. Okay, it's Malaysia. This facility is going into Malaysia. Malaysia makes them. Now there's a broader geopolitical context that you've got to be aware of. Now you've got to be much more aware of trade policy and twists and turns and changes in trade policy. So for multinational corporations, this new world we're heading into is going to be immensely, immensely more complicated, and their kind of honeymoon, the luxury that they previously enjoyed is disappearing rapidly. The last element, and again, this is just taking form, so we can just kind of see some broad strokes here, but the last element of this that I'd be comfortable mentioning is, I think it's almost certain that we are going to see a much more tenuous path for developing countries, which I think is going to be bad news, unfortunately, for a lot of developing countries. You know, the export-led development model, which was, you know, in so many respects, the most graphic representation of the success of the post-war rules-based global trade system, that so many developing countries moved up the economic development ladder through export-led growth, it's going to be much tougher. It is going to be much, much, much tougher. I don't think anyone will ever replicate anything even wildly approximating China's success. I mean, China, whether it was through deliberate planning or whether it was through sheer luck, China had perfect timing. It was the absolute perfect timing from almost every point of view to pursue an export-led development model. Any developing country that's aspiring to be the next China, reevaluate, become more realistic. It's not going to happen. And the other respect in which I think life is going to become a lot tougher and a lot more tenuous for less developed countries is there's going to be increasing pressure on them to pick a side. Okay? Increased pressure as these ecosystems get created, as a democratic ecosystem gets created. There's going to be pressure. Who do you want to sign up for? You know, oh, you're developing, you're putting your digital trade rules in place. Are you going to put your digital trade rules in place and your technical standards in place in a way that reflects the way my group over here plays the game? Or are you going to set up your technical standards and your digital trade governance in a way that reflects what this group over here? And it's going to be tough as hell for less developed countries, because most less developed countries, and particularly in ASEAN, have very wisely and correctly perceived that they should not get dragged into a back and forth with the US and China, that you shouldn't tilt too much to one side or another. You should play both sides off against each other. And so this is going to be an uncomfortable position for them as the pressure gets increased to join these things. The other, and I'll end here, the other aspect in which it's going to be tough is that if you are a less developed country, you are going to feel pressure to join some of these trade groupings, like the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework, even though it might include some commitments you're not comfortable with. But it's fear of missing out. We're not quite ready to sign off for what these guys want us to sign up for, but boy, if we hold back, maybe the train's going to leave the station and we're going to be left behind. So it's this real, we're not ready to make this commitment on the one hand, but we have fear of missing out on the other hand. It's going to be a tough time to be a developing country under these circumstances. okay, guys, I'm gonna stop there. As I said, I know that you need to be focused on all of these specific issues. We can talk about any of those as much as you like. I've got strong feelings on almost all of the topics I've mentioned, and many of my opinions diverge from what you're hearing from other people. So I'd be happy to share that. But especially on your first day, I wanted to sketch this broader tapestry because I think it'll be very useful for you as you focus on the threads. So I'll draw my comments to a close there and look forward to any comments or questions. Thanks. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much for your in-depth presentation. I have a question about forced to choose. I'm from Pakistan, so I will ask from a Pakistani perspective. Like, Pakistan wants an agreement with Iran, but due to the pressure from the US, we can't do that. Like, recently, due to the Ukraine crisis, we have to sign an agreement with the Russian, but due to the pressure from the US, we can't sign that agreement, the cheap oil. So how can the developing countries can cope this issue?
Well, thank you, because you just provided two crystal clear and two perfect examples of this very tenuous position that less developed countries are going to find themselves in. And the answer to your question is there is no answer to your question. I mean, there's, you know, you want this agreement with Russia, you want this agreement with Iran, it makes sense for you, but you've got to say, is it worth alienating the U.S. and the other countries that will potentially alienate? There's not a great solution. I mean, it's a very, very, very tough situation for less developed countries to be in. And I think examples like that now, unfortunately, are going to multiply. So I really don't envy the leaders of less developed countries that are facing these pressures, because the pressure is only going to intensify from here out. And there's no easy answer. There's no easy answer.
This side. Yeah. So my question, you see that, you know, now it's a more fragmented system and countries will focus on geopolitical outlook rather than economic efficiency. You know, I'm talking from the India perspective. In India's case, for instance, after the war, India has continued to buy oil from Russia, right?
Mm-hmm.
Both US and Russia are India's ally. So where does this thing fit into India's narrative? Because it's looking at economic efficiency, because
we're
buying cheaper oil.
Yep.
And we are, you know, taking both sides.
Yep.
So how does it work?
Well, it's a wonderful balancing act. I mean, it really tests the skill of the political leaders to see how you can benefit from kind of both sides without alienating one or the other. And just to be clear, we're not saying that economic efficiencies have disappeared from the equation. Right? I mean, their economic efficiencies are still always going to be there and always going to be compelling. But as you weigh those economic efficiencies, there's going to be this increased geopolitical consideration. Well, the oil really makes sense from Russia, and we really like to take this oil from Russia. Is it worth the blowback that we're going to get from the United States and other countries? So the economic argument, the economic rationale for trade and investment relationships does not disappear. It's made more complex by the fact that you have to weigh this stuff in. But it is, you know, it is an opportunity for very skillful sort of diplomatic, you know, gamesmanship to see how can I, representing India, how can I, representing Pakistan, how can I, representing any country, you know, try to keep all my options open, do what's right for my country, and not get myself into trouble because I've tilted too heavily. Now, ASEAN's been doing a great job of it. I mean, ASEAN has done a great job of it, and Singapore has elevated it to an art form. Singapore could, you know, write a PhD thesis on how you play off the US and China against each other. So Singapore's done a great job of it. You know, other countries might, but it's tough, and it's gonna get tougher.
In 2019, 2020, we saw an announcement by Australia, Japan, and India on SCRI, the Supply Chain Resilience Initiative. Now, this IPAF is a similar thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
But nothing much has moved on SARI front. So how hopeful should we be that, you know, now it's actually a small group of countries trying to secure their supply chains?
Thanks for the question. It gives me an opportunity to share some thoughts on a topic that will be important. This is strictly my opinion. I don't have a tremendous amount of confidence in these types of agreements. I don't have a tremendous amount of confidence necessarily in the Indo-Pacific economic framework. I think more times than not, it ends up being a talk shop where people spin their wheels and we look up and 3 years have gone by, what in concrete terms happened? And the answer all too often is nothing. In terms of the Indo-Pacific economic framework, there's a really important ingredient here that you've got to keep front and center. And that is the negotiating dynamic is entirely different because the United States has said, we're not giving you any market access benefits. Now, in the past, because everybody wanted enhanced access to the United States market, that provided the US with leverage to say, look, you want to get this access to our market, you better do what we want on digital trade, or you better do what we want on resilient supply chains. The Indo-Pacific economic framework is going to be fascinating because for the first time, the US doesn't have this leverage that it's had to get countries to go along with things that they might not be enthusiastic about. Now, I think it's premature to draw any conclusions about where IPEF might go. I think it's entirely possible it becomes a complete non-event, not the least of which because optimistically they say 24 months to negotiate, and guess what? The American people are going to the voting polls and they're going to elect the president in 2022. So it's really unclear to me if IPEF will go anywhere, but please keep an eye on it. Please keep an eye on it, because if it works, this could be the new template, right? If they really manage to accomplish something, this will be the new template on how to do free trade agreements without doing free trade agreements, right? So worth keeping an eye on. I have no idea which way it's going to break. It's too early. It's too early to tell.
Hello. So economy and trade is like a rat race for developing world and developing for developed countries. So. And for developing countries, we didn't even exist in this race. So what it means, developing countries mean for developed world, like in Pakistan, we say, or Pak-China friendship. So it is really, do you think it is really friendship or what?
Well, short answer, I don't know. I suspect the answer to your question will vary from country to country, and I'll take it even a step further. I think the answer to that question will vary within the government and within different agencies and within different individual senior officials within those countries. So I don't think there's a single answer. I think we have to have a certain amount of realpolitik about this. I mean, I think the United States is interested. A big part of its interest in the Indo-Pacific economic framework is because it understands correctly so that it's lost tremendous influence to China in the region. It now, in retrospect, views that as a mistake and is trying to reassert itself in the region. How much of that is driven by real friendship for the countries? I don't know. But let's face it, I think there's a certain amount of realpolitik going on here.
Thank you. Hi. Thank you for talking with us. So I've been reporting on Sri Lanka recently because it's facing its worst economic crisis. As it's trying to come out of it, you know, you talk to people there about, you know, what's the way forward. It's very much a plan on boosting exports. And you were just talking about how export-led development cards, what those options are for developing countries. And I was just curious to understand, you know, from the perspective of Sri Lanka, I mean, is is the answer still on exports? I'm talking about 5 years later, once they stabilized. Similarly, in India, manufacturing is still a big driver for the government to create mass employment, but it's looking like that's not at all going to be an easy way forward. So I'm just curious to understand what you see as the answer.
Here's what I would say. I mean, if I was hired as a high-priced consultant to the government of Sri Lanka, I'd say, look, be realistic. I'm not saying, again, we're not saying drop trade. We're not saying forget trade. We're not saying trade is not going to, we're not saying that at all. However, recognize that trade is not going to be your silver bullet. That we've had for the past several decades an incredibly benign global environment for trade, right? I mean, it's been fairly placid seas, right? Like if you were a less developed country and you really wanted to hitch your wagon to the export-led development model, we got a long list of success stories, right? But that, you know, as Alex is saying, that world is done, over, and finished. Okay, that benign environment that really facilitated the ability of less developed countries to really rocket up the economic development ladder, China being the greatest example, it's much, much different. It doesn't mean forget trade. It doesn't mean give up on trade. It doesn't mean that trade can't be one component of something that's helpful. But understand, we're in a whole new world now, and trade is no longer going to be your silver bullet. That would be the best advice I would give.
How much of, do you think this is true, that the IPEF is meant to be a talk fest and that it is a subtle political signal for multinationals to look to it as a, you know, the license to go into certain kinds of deals? So in the past, they might have the FTAs to, you know, set up their legal frameworks and so and so. But now they look to it and say, well, this is the US, you know, being in a group with these people, therefore we now have to work and do deals with these countries. Mm-hmm. So it is a political signal more than anything else. And how many of those do you think will emerge in time to come?
I think it's an important part of it. I mean, I think let's face it, the optics are important. And the US felt it was very important to signal we're back. And so from that point of view, you know, the actual substance is less important if you're starting to change the perception. You know, the perception previously had been that the U.S. was entirely preoccupied fighting wars with the Middle East, and that they had kind of taken their eye off the ball, and that had and then had permitted China to really become the most influential country in the region. So, part of it is that optical presentation. But at the same time, honestly, I mean, I think there are legitimate policy objectives here. I mean, I think there is stuff that the U.S. trade agencies certainly want to come out of this. The digital, you know, the digital trade pillar of this agreement, they're deadly serious about that. I mean, they want to make progress there. They think if they can make progress in the Indo-Pacific region, it will bode well for wider agreements. So I think there's a certain amount, I think you're absolutely right, there's a certain amount of political posturing and just, you know, to present that the United States is back. But by the same token, I think there's a legitimate policy agenda here that they're going to try, that they're going to try to score on. Now again, how well they can do that because they no longer have the leverage of offering market access remains to be seen. But I think there's legitimate policy objectives.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yep.
You spoke about the taking sides. I mean, it's very interesting. Can you talk about the dilemma that ASEAN is facing? Because both US and China wants to do business with ASEAN. There's a lot of attention on ASEAN. And ASEAN countries are also friendly to both parties, most of the ASEAN countries. Do you think at one point they will be forced to choose, or do you think ASEAN will continue to enjoy this sweet spot?
You know, ASEAN is really arguably the primary or the biggest or the most important stage where this is playing out, right? Here's what I would say. don't underestimate ASEAN's ability to keep both sides, to play both sides off against each other. Nobody's had more practice. Nobody's become more skillful. Nobody's had a better role model than being able to look at the Singapore experience. So I think the pressure is going to heighten on ASEAN, both as an organization, you know, as a single entity, as well as the individual members. I think the pressure is going to heighten. But honestly, I don't for one minute underestimate the ability of ASEAN to avoid tilting. You know, they'll play the game. When they need to tilt in one direction, they'll tilt in that direction. Then they'll tilt back in the other direction to offset it. You can play a very sophisticated game here. And I wouldn't bet against their ability to do so. I mean, the other real interesting case study to keep a real close eye on is Indonesia's presidency of the G20. And I mean, you know, Joko Widodo has been under tremendous pressure, but I think he's done a decent job. I mean, I think he's done a very decent job in trying to be an honest broker in an organization that contains all of these diverse, not only diverse countries, in some cases, countries with diametrically opposite points of view. And I think he's doing, so far, I would give him pretty high marks. I think he's doing a good job in striking that balance and not getting pulled too far in one direction. So, I think ASEAN is going to be where a lot of this is going to play out. And I wouldn't bet against the ability of ASEAN nations to effectively play both sides off against each other.
How do you think the inflationary pressure globally, factors into discussions about trade policies? I mean, most recently there has been talks on the U.S. may, temporarily perhaps relieving, some of the tariffs on Chinese imports. I mean, do you think this is a temporary kind of adjustment to the shift to the trade framework as we just discussed?
Yeah. I'll make a couple of comments. One thing I'd say is look, I I'm sure you guys have as well. I've been reading competing reports, right? Like here's my stack of really highly credentialed, impressive economists who say cutting tariffs will have little or no impact on inflation. Here's my stack of reports from impressive, highly credentialed, really smart economists saying the exact opposite. I'm not in a position to adjudicate that difference of opinion, but what I would say is I don't think it's going to be a dramatic difference. And I think to the extent you see it coming up, and the extent to which you see it coming up in particular in the United States, is because of a political imperative. I mean, Janet Yellen wants to cut tariffs in order to address inflation. Well, my goodness gracious, Janet Yellen with her PhD in economics is damn well smart enough to know that cutting a few tariffs on bicycles from China is not going to move the gauge in any significant way on inflation. But she's part of an administration that has a political imperative to show the American people two things. This is like a political mantra. A, we get it. We feel your pain, Mr. and Mrs. Voter, we get it, and we're doing what we can. So there's this imperative to do something, even if in your heart of hearts as a policymaker, this really isn't going to be a big deal. There's midterm elections, and then there's a presidential election. And you have to show that you get it, and you're doing something. Gasoline tax, same thing. They're going to waive the gasoline tax. No credible economist thinks waiving the gasoline tax is going to make a profound impact on inflation. So why do it? The political imperative to do it.
Thank you for the presentation. My question is on developing countries. Export-led development, you said export-led development, but still open. So far I know some developing countries graduating to LDCs, from LDCs to middle income countries, they're going to face some challenges. So what strategies or what policy measures they can take? What is your suggestions to overcome that kind of challenge or steep path? Keep this path open.
The short answer is they won't be able to entirely overcome it. Okay, because this whole idea of less developed countries massively exporting to the rich developed economies, United States, European Union, that door isn't slammed shut, but it's not going to be open nearly to the extent it has in the past. Recognize the limitations, you know, still, as I said, don't forget trade, still have exports be part of your strategy, but recognize it's not going to play the same role that, for instance, it played in China. One thing that I think you're going to see countries at least attempt, and I don't know whether or not it will be successful, will be, okay, well, if we're not going to get rich by exporting more to the developed countries, what about in our region? What about countries at a similar level of development? Can we look for opportunities there? I think it's a possibility. I think it's a possibility, but, you know, a caveat. Again, if you come back to ASEAN and you look at ASEAN and all of the efforts to, you know, create an ASEAN economic community and to build trade ties among ASEAN, it just really hasn't coalesced the way that people have hoped. And if you're realistic, what you recognize is that, again, you know, for ASEAN, the economic synergies don't exist as much within ASEAN, so they don't exist so much between Indonesia and Malaysia, but they exist between Indonesia and Korea and Malaysia and Japan. So you can try that route, but you have to be realistic that to a large extent, these economies are competitors. You know, certainly that's the case within ASEAN, that these countries are competitors and they don't have the synergistic relationships to the extent you would hope. And it's interesting, if you look at the data over decades, despite all of the free trade agreements, all the efforts, you know, most FDI within ASEAN comes from outside of ASEAN. You know, it's not Vietnam investing in the Philippines, it's Japan investing in the Philippines. So I think it's an option. I think countries should consider that in light of the relatively diminished opportunities in the rich developed countries. I'm not sure it will always work though.
Thank you.
You said during your talk that China had perfect timing when it came to its economic development. I think everyone would probably agree with that. But has that timing sort of abandoned it now? Because if we're moving into this era of strategic competition and perhaps diverse, you know, two sort of economic systems around the world, technological systems around the world, I mean, is China perhaps not quite ready to take that leap, you know, when it comes to trying to phase down the U.S. and its network of allies and economic partners?
It's a really interesting question, and it's one that I've thought a lot about. I think we're still too early to answer it definitively, but here's what I would say. So Xi Jinping pretty much blatantly came out and said, this whole idea of hide your power and bide your time, which had defined China's external policy for X number of decades. He pretty much came out and said, that's outdated and I'm not playing the game by those rules anymore. I think it's entirely possible that when we get 20 years down the line, 30 years down the line, we'll look back and we'll see that as a strategic miscalculation, that he came out perhaps a little bit too early, a little bit before China was perhaps ready for this brave new world that it's pushed itself into. We'll see. It's a little bit early to tell, but yeah, they got the timing right when it came to the initial decades of their development and the export-led development model. They might have screwed up the timing a little bit on this one.
Steve, thank you so much. Okay. And we really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
Thank you. And I think you all have Steve's card. If not, his information is in the program. So feel free to reach out to him about this or any other any other global trade issue.
Guys, can connect with me on LinkedIn, Twitter, all that stuff, and anything that I can help with, I'm delighted to do so. Let's not regard this as a one-off, okay? Please stay in touch with me, and if you just want to kick around some ideas or just informally talk about things, it would be my pleasure. So please take me up on that.
Thank you so much.